Good morning. I'd like to welcome you to worship this morning. In the way of announcements, please place your offering in the plate in the back, or you can send in a check to 20 Main Street, Bridgeton. Tonight, the Bayshore Ministerium Hymn Sing is going to be held down the street at the Fairfield Presbyterian Church at 6 p.m. This Saturday, we'll be decorating the church for Christmas at 9 a.m. Come out if you're able to help for a little bit. Need Advent candle letters and readers? I have a few volunteers, but if you don't volunteer, you might get asked, so expect that coming. And starting next Sunday is Family Worship Sunday, but it's also Advent, and we're starting a new series, The Heart That Grew Three Sizes, Finding Faith in the Story of the Grinch. And looking ahead, the next Bible study, we're skipping this week for the holiday, but next one will be December 1st at noon. That Saturday after that, Newport's UMW is having their rummage sale part 2 from 9 to 1. I put wrong in the bulletin because I didn't write it down or put it in my phone. The prayer breakfast will be canceled next month because we have a council meeting at 9 a.m. on the 11th. And our family night dinner will be December 14th at 6 p.m. Is there any other announcements? Yes, I said that one. I just called it something different. Thank you, though. That's the one I made the boo-boo and put wrong in the bulletin. Anything else? Let's go to God in prayer this morning. Lord, we come this day rejoicing in the presence of you as the King of Kings. At his birth, the angels proclaimed his name to be Emmanuel, God with us. Today in this place, in the name of worship, may we truly feel the power and presence of Jesus. May our hearts be warmed and challenged to proclaim with our lives, Christ is King and Lord. Amen. Please stand if you're able for the call to worship. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Holiness is the beauty of God's temple while time shall last. We worship God in the sanctity and freedom from our sins, which Christ gives us through his lifeblood. Our first hymn is number 569. We have a story to tell to the nation.
Show us.
Apostles' Creed. It's 881 in our hymn. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Now wave and say hello to your neighbors. You may be seated. Now it's time to share your joys and your concerns. What's going on this morning? Nothing? Right? But she is home, correct? Mary's home. So continue healing for Mary Boker. Anything else? Yeah. And Mosma was definitely happy that the Sutton showed up. He was standing like a looking like a lost puppy dog, waiting for his friends to come. He says he likes to come to church because his friends are there. And so he was, I guess we're chopped liver, but you know how the hierarchy with children is. Anything else? We have some that we regularly remember. Mrs. Blue, Miss Mary, we mentioned, Mrs. Lanning, Reds, Bev, Jenny, Hope, and Connie. We also lift up unspoken requests, a list of those with cancer. Craig for direction and peace. Jason, who has a trach, is going home on that ventilator. Cameron, who had a surgery, hip surgery, is having pain. Healing for quite a few people. Josh, who's in the Navy. We had the shooting here in Fairton this week. I still haven't got the lady's name, but it's Roy's wife, or Mr. Roy's wife, Mrs. Roy, I don't know. We're gonna say Roy's wife, because God knows what I'm talking about. God's used to my weird prayers anyway. And Shelly Fithian, she's watching this morning, or she was. She's in the hospital, she's been in there since Thursday. She's having breathing problems, but she just said here she's coming home probably Tuesday. It's not COVID, it's just like pneumonia or something to that nature. Anything else you want to share? All right, just go to God in prayer this morning. Lord, we do thank you that we have children that are enough to make some noise, to remind us of what life can be in the church, that there can be a happiness as well as time of reverence. We also want to lift up those we regularly remember, Mrs. Blue, Miss Mary, Mrs. Lanning, Reds, Bev, Jenny, Hope, and Connie. We thank you for the progress Mary's made. I pray you continue to strengthen her body as she comes home and does hopefully what they tell her to do to keep her strength up and encourage her spirit as well. We also want to lift up unspoken requests. Maybe someone's watching online or someone just doesn't feel comfortable sharing. Lord, I ask you to hear those prayers. We also want to lift up those with cancer. Sherry Fisher Riley, Mike, Jennifer, Nick, Charlie, Lawrence, and Diane. We ask for healing for them, body, mind, and spirit. For Jen and Craig, I pray for peace. For Jason, who has this trach he's going home with, I pray for his caregivers. And all that, and for him as he adjusts to this transition. For Cameron, who's having a lot of pain after hip surgery, I pray for healing and for his pain to be managed better. I also pray for healing for Dina, for Gail, for Beth, for Bobby, and Pastor Ghost. Lord, you know whatever their needs are at this time for healing, so I ask that for them as well. For Josh Wolf, who's in the Navy, I ask for your protection and for wisdom as he does his daily test. I also lift up Roy's wife and the town of Fairton after another shooting. I ask for your comfort and your peace for our community and for healing for this lady as well. I also pray for justice to be found in the situation this person faces the punishment they deserve. I also lift up Shelly, who's in the hospital, and I ask for healing for her and extra patience as she's dealing with poking and beeping and interrupted sleep. I pray for continued healing for her, though. I thank you for a week where we give thanks. We have so much to be thankful for, and Lord, I ask that you would help us to have a grateful spirit today. And hear us now as we pray the prayer you taught your disciples. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now it's time for the children's message. Miss Julie has it this morning. Oops. Can't switch this around. Come on.
Peace is quiet.
It is.
And it's also calm. A wreath? What kind of wreath? What's the
Christmas wreath?
Close. But what's special about it? What's the next 4 weeks? What's the season? It's the
Christmas. It has a little bit of leaves that have a little
winter.
Yes, it does. It's Advent. And Advent means waiting. We're going to wait. And when we light these candles on each Sunday, it's to help us to stop and think and pray and remember what we're waiting for and the real reason that we have Christmas. Okay? So we're going to do that tomorrow.
Christmas is in the winter.
Christmas is in the winter. And what's special about Christmas? What is it?
Winter.
Why do we have Christmas?
Because of presents from Santa.
Well, you have presents from Santa, but what's the real important meaning of Christmas? That's exactly right. Well, Jesus' birthday. So why do we wait for Jesus' birthday to come?
I love you, Jesus.
Aww. We're going to light a candle underneath, okay? Let's say a prayer, okay? Dear God, thank you for letting us all be here today. Help us to remember in the time leading up to Christmas, in the Advent season, that we remember the real meaning of Christmas, which is Jesus' birthday. Amen.
Amen.
Because it's always right. Right? Let's see. All right. Okay. Please stand if you're able for our next hymn. It's wrong in the bulletin. That bulletin lady is going to get fired. 196. Come thou expected, long expected Jesus. From the Gospel of John, John 18, verses 33 to 37. Pilate entered the praetorium again and called Jesus and said to him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" And Jesus answered, "Do you say this of your own accord, or did others say it to you about me?" Pilate answered, Am I a Jew? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done? Jesus answered, my kingship is not of this world. My servants would fight that I might not be handed over to the Jews, but my kingship is not from this world. Pilate said to him, so you are a king. And Jesus answered, you say that I'm a king. For this I was born, and for this I have come into the world to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice. May God bless the reading of his word this morning. Today is celebrated in the wider Christian church as Christ the King Sunday. The entire church year has almost played out, and we've been leading up to this day. It's like a sports season coming together for the finals, where the champions determine. Although likely we won't see anyone dancing in the aisles today in celebration, today is the championship day of the church year. You might be thinking to yourself, well, what about Easter? Isn't that the most special day of the church year? Or you might say, well, there's Christmas coming up. Isn't that also a very special day? And these are truly special days, but the way that the calendar design leads to this day. And this day is a very special one to consider, that by the end of this church service, the church calendar comes full circle. Because the church liturgical, that's a nice big word, liturgical year begins with Advent, like Julie was talking about, where we prepare for the birth of Jesus, and they celebrate his birth, and at Christmas. Then at the end of the year, the church moves through ordinary time. We go through Jesus' life, then all of a sudden we're green everywhere for months. The long system season of green, which we would finish just this past week. Now we're called to reflect on the kingdom of God in our everyday life. It's all moving towards the end. At the end of the year, we deal with death and eternal life, the communion of the saints, all leading up to this Sunday, Christ the King, which talks about the lordship of Jesus. And in our gospel lesson from John, Pilate seems confused as to what Jesus has done, and he is also confused whether or not he is a king. My kingdom is not of this world, Jesus says. It seems that he did come here to earth to establish a kingdom, though. It's just not what we were expecting. To understand the kingdom language of Jesus, we have to know something about context. They put that in your head all the time. Context, context, context in seminary. And we also have to look at the leadership structure of their day. This had everything to do with another leader, King Herod. You've heard of Herod. Well, he died actually the year Jesus was born. But Jesus was born in a stable in Bethlehem. Herod, he was buried about 3 miles east of Bethlehem, in a massive mountain fort called Herodium, named it after himself, of course. Now, Jesus' birth, despite the significance that we give to it, was a quiet affair. But the Herod's burial was just the opposite. He literally had a mountain constructed in the flat desert. He wanted people to think of him, see that mountain, and honor him long after he died. In fact, you can see that Herodium from Jerusalem. It's impressive, and a few people still visit it today, just not as many that go to Bethlehem. Herod, he ruled for 34 years. He's very powerful. He still has influence there seen in Israel today. He built the city of Caesarea on the coast near Tel Aviv, built Masada, which was an ancient fort, one of Israel's most popular tourist attractions today. And most curiously, he rebuilt the temple. A portion of that still survives today as the Wailing Wall, or the Western Wall, another tourist attraction. He was not a religious man, but he used religion for all his own purpose. Everything between sports, art, architecture, shrines, palaces, all of this he built up to show his power and establish his legacy. So Jesus was born into this kingdom of Herod, and he was born into the time of mighty King Herod and his legacy. Knowing that, wouldn't it be a good idea to learn from Herod's long reign? I mean, Herod certainly wasn't a nice guy, but we can learn something from him. Nice guy or not, he still held a lot of power and was an effective leader. But Jesus quickly realized his way of leadership would not be Herod's. My kingdom, he says to Pilate, is not of this world. And the temptation of Jesus, of course, would have been to model his technique, his methods after Herod, but with a different outcome and a different goal. This was the temptation of Jesus in the wilderness in Matthew and Luke. The devil takes Jesus to a high mountain and shows him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor and says, "All this I will give you if you fall down and worship me." To follow Jesus is to profess him as Lord, the basic Christian conviction. To believe that Jesus is Lord is to honor and glorify him above all else, above all other rulers and authorities. Jesus came upon this earth to establish the kingdom of God, an alternative to the kingdom of Herod. He spoke not of the love of power, but of the power of love. And he clearly gave his presence, his spirit, his authority to his disciples to spread his influence, his teaching, his goodness upon the earth until he comes again. And so on Christ the King Sunday, we not only magnify the Lord as King, we are called upon to be upon establishing that kingdom here on earth. So what does all this mean for us? As disciples of Christ the King, we are tempted toward two errors doing godly work. One is to despair, to give up. We pray every Sunday, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." Yet sometimes it seems that not much changes. And so we're tempted to be passive, just watching as the world goes by. And a second temptation is to use the world's methods to accomplish a good result, to believe the end justifies the means. And so we're tempted to use Herod's kind of power to achieve Jesus' intentions. Jesus rejects both of these ways, to give up or to compromise. If we are doing the work of Jesus, we do it in the way of Jesus. And so leadership in the way of Jesus is always being a servant, leading as a servant. Because any power that comes as a gift. And it's power wielded not for the love of power or acquiring things, but the power of love in a broken world. We're children of a king. And as we sit here this morning with all our faults, anxieties, our struggles, our burdens, all mixed into this wonderful things that we all do, never forget that we are God's both now and always. And as Christians, we may not have a big shiny trophy to lift high as to celebrate a championship, but we have something much better. We have something far more precious and enduring than shiny pieces of silver or plastic. The victory on this day of the finals is to know that Christ, our King, has claimed us as his own, and no power in this world can break that relationship. Instead of a trophy to lift high, we can use our hands, minds, and feet, and our hearts to raise high the power of love to a world that so sorely needs it, to raise high the victory of a king over sin and death, to raise high the knowledge of the power of love that endures, and to point to the champion, to Jesus. The entire church leader has led us up to this day. So let's rejoice in it, be thankful, and kneel down before our King as we give our heartfelt thanks for God's amazing grace. I can't think of a better way to end a season. Thanks be to God. Amen. So is there a favorite song you would like to sing either from the book or from the hymnal today? Yes, Margaret.
Yeah, 131.
Okay. Yes, a good Thanksgiving hymn. We gather together. Why don't we sing all three verses? We gather together.
We gather together to ask the
Did I miss a verse or something? Oh, okay. I thought I was on the wrong verse by the end.
I'm taking the wrong verse all the way around. It's okay.
That's all right. God loves our voices. The problem is I lose myself sometimes in the middle of it, so I'm just going along. We needed to sing it because it's Thanksgiving, so I didn't know how to work it into the king thing, so that's why it came up in the hymn sing. Somebody else have a song they'd like to sing? All right, 394, Something Beautiful. We'll sing it through twice, Something Beautiful. Is Thanksgiving, so make sure you take a moment to thank God for all you're thankful for. Even if it's just a roof over your head and pennies in your pocket, it's more than some people have, so we need to be grateful. Anything else? 77. Okay. All right, we'll sing first and last, How Great Thou Art. This will always be Mr. J's song, but...
I
hit that note. Whoop, I wasn't even trying. I'm getting too old to try to hit high notes or something. Old and fat, I guess. I don't know what's going on. Somebody else have a favorite they'd like to sing? It's a rough week, huh? All right, I'll pick the last one then. 474, Precious Lord, Take My Hand. Please stand if you're able. It'll be our last one. And sing the first and the last. 474. Go now in peace. Bring the good news of God's eternal love to those you meet. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ also, and the fellowship of the Spirit to everyone you meet. Go in peace. Amen.